Jesus, 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 Jes can call him into your situation, there's nothing that he will not overcome from you. More than you need a program or a session or a meeting, you need Jesus.
Amen.
If you are not totally free, who is your King? There is not one area of your life that you cannot be completely free in. If Jesus Christ is your King, if you understand what can happen when Jesus Christ comes into that situation, what situation have you not called Jesus?
Thank you.
tendrils of hopelessness about. I want you to surrender that to God right now. I want you to picture an altar. See, we don't want to just bring the best parts of us as an offering to worship. We need to bring the parts that we don't know what to do with. And before we figure those parts out, or before the finances are there, we need to put those feelings on the altar. And you will know that you've truly surrendered them to Him when His fire consumes it. Anything that is an acceptable offering, He will consume with fire. Amen. I feel really strong. Give Him any strand of hope.
Life for him. The crazy thing about it. grow. I feel weights that this week has grown. I want you to just see what's been bothering you, what's been plaguing you. In just a minute, we're going to breathe out. And we're going to say every spirit, every contrary spirit, every evil, unclean spirit, go. And then we're going to breathe in the breath of God. Do you know the Holy Spirit means breath? Did you know when Raina was having her baby, it was so interesting to me, the midwife's instructions. As the contractions came, they would say, hold your breath, push. And when she would hold her breath, but then she would accidentally breathe and say, you're wasting that breath. The breath is what moves the baby.
Wow.
The breath. The breath of God is what will cause the things in you that feel blocked to break through. But do you know what she needed to do between contractions? I asked the midwife what was the best advice I could give her. She said, in between the contractions, if she can relax fully. So when the pressure comes, that's when you have the breath of God. And the pressure's off. You know that sometimes the pressure that's on you is not from the devil. It's from God. Otherwise, how would you have patient endurance? The Bible says patient endurance is what you need now so you'll finish this race. So sometimes you're trying to get rid of the very situation that has come to produce patient endurance that will secure your faith. The pressure is there to birth the baby. You feel pressure and you're rebuking Satan every breath. The pressure is there to produce the baby. The pressure is there to produce more faith. The pressure is there to produce your character. When the pressure's not there, great, relax. But when the pressure's there, by the breath of God, produce life. Your life is not just for you to be happy. Your life is to produce more life. God's life in your life is to produce more life. Did you know that? So when the pressure's there, stop feeling like, oh, I'm being attacked. Oh, I'm being attacked. You might be having a baby. Push by the breath of God.
Amen.
He's teaching us. I don't have notes on this. I've not thought of this. When the pressure comes, stop rebuking the devil every breath. Unless the Holy Spirit shows you this is a demonic attack against you, rebuke it.
Yeah.
Otherwise, breathe the breath of life and push.
Amen.
The pressure is there to produce life in you, out of you, from you. The pressure is coming so that you will produce more lives in Him.
Yes.
How many of you have been under pressure this week? Let's be honest. How many of you thought it was the devil? Be honest. How many of you thought it was the devil? I don't believe half of y'all. How about it was the devil? And you're rebuking the devil with every breath. Or just hoping he'll leave you alone. Some of you might have recognized this God because you've been teaching about these things. Fire of God over you. Huh? Yes. The Lord is so good. He has a plan for your life, and if you can ever trust Him, that plan will unfold. Mm-hmm. You think, what is God's plan for my life? You are. What is blocking the plan of God in my life? You are.
with no pressure.
Amen.
That's not what it's about.
You will have pressure.
You will. The Bible said, why could Paul have them and we could somehow get away with it? Without pressure. Without that molding, that forming. Without that pushing. I think sometimes we just want a life of ease. Amen?
Amen.
A life of ease. A life of ease more than a life of peace. Because if you have a life of peace, you can be easy in any situation.
Well, he's, teaching you how, he's teaching you how to live in the situation instead of get away from it and get out of it. You know?
Amen. That's so
he's
good.
He's teaching you how to fight. They're hoping that the troubles get moved, and he's purposely bringing those troubles so that you can build your character and your perseverance, and you can learn to stand. And instead of learning how to fight, we look to get out of it, you know?
Right.
Which is why people jump from, like, place to place, job to job, relationship to relationship. I mean, it's all running, hoping that that thing's going to leave, and God, you know, sure, go date the other person, just guess what? Here it is, you know?
Wow.
Here's the storm.
I see people treat as distraction the very thing that God has brought into their life. I see mothers treat and fathers treat their children as bothersome distractions. They are the very things that God has brought to mold their character, to form them into being like Him. And they think, and I see people post about it, that their passion is their ministry. Oh, if it weren't for children. But we need to minister them to you. Are you kidding me? Mm-hmm. Are you kidding me? Our children are the best gifts from God.
Yes.
And I heard the Lord say this past week, remember, do not babysit your children out of growing. Because now there are more people that are willing to keep the children, and my children are easy with. And it would be easier for me, every meeting I take, everything I'm doing, to get them with someone. And I heard the Lord say, don't babysit them out of their destiny. Mm-hmm. Amen. Yes. And then I heard two of the pastors that I trust the most talking about the very thing. And it was just quick confirmation. You know, because before this church was formed, I took my children into Muslim homes, into a Hindu priest home, praying. My children went everywhere I went. T.B. Joshua was, I heard him saying this morning that his mother cleaned the floors and the seats of the church when he was a boy. And she brought him with her. And he would hear her praying. And as she cleaned, she was saying, oh Lord, as I'm cleaning your house, clean my life. As I clean your house, clean my children. Oh God, clean my children. As I clean your house, clean my life. As I clean your house, clean my children. And he said, I'm a product of that prayer. I'm a product of that prayer. I heard a woman last week giving a testimony, and God blessed her with two children. He said, I'm bringing those children into every revelation. Every breakthrough, every blessing you have, are you bringing your children and teaching them? So I heard Guillermo talking this morning about Hezekiah. Hezekiah was going to die, and then he asked the Lord to spare him, and God answers praying to give him more life. But he did not give back to the Lord to match that blessing of life, and his children went into idolatry. And I just want to expound on that. What has the Lord done for you? And are you giving back in proportion? Mm-hmm. Has He saved your life ever? Whose physical life has been spared?
Yes.
So have you given your entire life to Jesus and the work of heaven? Maybe not, huh? How many of you have been healed from a disease or sickness? Have you paid back that debt? He said Hezekiah did it, and his children went to help. That is very interesting. That is really, really interesting. You know, after the children of Israel in the promised land, the Bible says there arose a generation that knew not God. Our children will know God one day.
Amen.
Our children will know God.
Amen.
Builder told me this week, and he told me this before, and reminded me of this. He said, never accept a phase from your children.
Wow.
Don't accept, oh, it's just a phase. Mm-hmm. No, he said, I will show you who they truly are. And every day, unless you see who they truly are, continue. He said, don't give them space. The culture today goes, give them space. You don't want to push them away from them. No.
Yeah.
You give them space, the world's coming to teach them.
Amen.
Don't give them space.
Amen.
Give them so much love and kindness. So much mercy. I really feel the Spirit of the Lord on the children today. About teaching our children. What are we giving our children? We can give them toys and punishment. And no guidance and love. And think about your spiritual children. As you grow, God's bringing people into your life and you're mentoring. The Bible gives some advice about raising children. Most of the New Testament is it will point toward kindness, gentleness. Don't make your children angry. Otherwise, they may give up, become discouraged, and quit trying. What does the Bible say? Don't lead. See, I see many people trying to lead a ministry, and their children are not secured and protected and guided and respectful. The Bible says that's a no-go.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know why he's saying all this, but please
let him
say
what
he wants to. Yes.
1 Peter 1:13 through something. I don't know all of it. The rest of the Bible. Just as you were talking about children, I'm with you on that. Therefore, prepare your minds for action. Be self-controlled. Set your hope fully on the grace to be given you when Jesus Christ is revealed. Verse 14. As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance. But just as he who has called you holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, be holy, for I am holy. Now I'm thinking about what you're talking about. It's hard to lead our children in obedience when we don't live in obedience. And what we do is we let our kids get away with stuff because we didn't either get away with it, or we don't know how to control it, or we don't know how to handle it. And so then our kids lead us, and then we try to love them by giving them everything that either we didn't have or that they asked for so that we can try to be obedient. And we're the ones that are being disobedient, which in turn makes our children disobedient. It's hard to set boundaries for your children when we're not obedient. Mm-hmm. When we don't have the boundaries, or we don't respect the boundaries, or we don't eat of that tree. I'm in a rush, let me eat of that tree real quick, and then your child sees you eating the tree. No, you can't do that. We wonder why. I mean, that to me is the generation we live in.
Yeah.
Because we tell our kids a lot of different things, mm-hmm. and we don't do them. And I used to be really, really guilty of that. Maybe I still am. Someone spilled coffee.
Our parenting out of fear.
Yeah. I think somebody
went to get the towel.
Parenting out of fear and punishment.
Yeah.
The Lord is really talking to us, and I think it's because the babies are coming. Literally, we see manifest in the physical and also the spiritual babies. And we need to learn how to be patient with those who are less spiritually mature than us. The Bible says be gentle. Be patient in teaching them. The Lord is really speaking about the babies, isn't he? The babies.
I love that you said bring them into every situation. So, like, a lot of you are babies in this room. Now you may. You're grown. You're big. Cool pretzels, cool hat. But a lot of y'all are babies, and I can see what's happening is, like, Brandon and I have been meeting a lot more lately, and I can see the Lord, me pulling Brandon into things. And the more time, because a lot of times, I don't like to bring my kids to the grocery store because they ask for every single thing at every single aisle. And so it was easier for me to just say, stay with your mama, I'm going to run, and I'll be back in 10 minutes, instead of me bringing you and be back in an hour.
Oh, wow.
But I realized the more that I bring them with me, the more spiritual truths are being revealed to them, because if y'all have ever met my children, they ask 8 billion questions. Why is the sky with that color? Why don't they look like all others? Yeah, but what if it was green? Well, then it would be amazing. That's what God did. Anyways, we start doing that, but I realized the more time I would bring them, Elijah always, without question, he's going to see somebody and say, have we prayed for them before? Why does she have a thing on her wrist? Why are they limping? Why are they in a car? Why? Have we prayed for them? Should we go pray for them? And I realized what you're talking about is it's not sheltering people from life. You guard yourself, but you don't go and protect it. You're covered and fully filled, but you live life. And so, because we are all babies still, we need to learn to be obedient so that our children have no choice but to be obedient. Because then we're showing them the way instead of telling them the way.
That's so good.
It's why people don't receive Jesus, because we tell them the way to heaven is you repent with your mouth and you believe in your heart. We don't tell them anything about love. We don't tell them about repentance. We don't even tell them to show them how to believe, but we tell them how to do it.
Jesus. Yes, we're speaking. A lot of people are speaking from defeat about victory. Do you hear me? Some people are witnessing from defeat about victory. I want you to witness about victory from victory.
That's so good.
And there's a way. And if you think there is no way, your mind needs to be renewed. Your mind needs to be renewed. How do we renew our minds? Meditating on the Word. By the Holy Spirit. Meditating on the Word. By the Holy Spirit. Meditating on the Word. By the Holy Spirit.
Can I read this in the Message real quick? It says, same scripture. It says, so roll up your sleeves, put your mind in gear, be totally ready to receive the gift that's coming when Jesus arrives. It means you've got to be prepared for something. Be ready. Don't lazily slip back into those old grooves of evil, doing just what you feel like doing. You didn't know any better then, but you do now. That's for somebody in this room. You didn't know better then, but you do now.
Yeah.
So don't condemn yourself, but move forward. As obedient children, let yourselves be pulled into a way of life, shaped by God's life. A life energetic and blazing with holiness. God said, I am holy, you be holy. We're going to get back to holiness.
Yes.
I can feel there's a season coming where he's leading us back to put that at the forefront because it's who he is. I'm sure Michelle just read the...
No, holiness, the temple.
That's right. Michelle used the redeeming before it spoke.
Yes.
We have to be obedient children. What in your life are you not being obedient to? And I'm talking about like major things, because usually the major things you'll run into them every now and again and you'll realize they're there. You know what I mean? Like if there's a tree in your way, you can't drive somewhere, there's a tree there. But if there's like a whole bunch of little rocks that don't belong, you probably just drive over them most times because they've always been there. What are we not being obedient? I'm thinking about tithing. Tithing is something that I know we don't teach a lot about tithing, but we're going to start teaching on it, not to convince you to give, but because it's a biblical principle. And so like we talked Friday night, sometimes we go too far the other way to not say anything about it because we really don't want your money. But, and every church we've been to is about giving, giving, giving. You always talk about giving. You make it super convenient, and then you convince them to give, and then you make sure that they're giving, and then you check the farm, and then you know. Darius was telling me some stuff I'm not going to bring up about some of the churches he came from, and it's crazy. But, so we went so far the other way to not talk about tithing. But, do you tithe 10% out of what he's giving you? Mm-hmm. Or are you giving the government theirs, insurance company theirs, car payment theirs, rent theirs, your groceries, and then whatever you have left? Are you giving 10% of your leftovers? That's what Cheyenne started talking about. Of all he's given to you, are you giving back in proportion? 10 lepers were healed. What percent came back? 10%. One.
To thank him.
Thank you.
And so there were 10 lepers healed, but there was one leper who was healed.
Forgiven. Don't worry. It's okay. Just a slight little.
That's
hilarious. Hey Nathan, hey Elle.
Kind of like throwing the mic, but no.
10 lepers, 9 healed, 1 healed and
one
forgiven. Would you rather be healed or healed and forgiven? I mean, think about that. They were so okay with just their received fresh new skin, one leper received a fresh new heart. Yes.
Alright, so obviously Shine and I talk a lot, so clearly we knew what we were doing this morning. Verse 17. It says, since you call on the Father who judges each man's work impartially, live your lives as strangers here in reverent fear. For you know that it was not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your forefathers, but with the precious blood of Jesus. I got to thinking this morning about, and if you keep going on, it goes deeper into the gold thing. But I used to buy and sell gold for a living. And so what we would do is, as the gold would come in, the person that bought it for a certain price would say, well, this is 14 karat gold, this is a mixture of 10 and 14, this is 18, 22, 24, whatever. And so what we would do is we would melt it down in this crucible at about 1800 degrees. And then as it's in liquid form, you could actually see the gold with all the impurities around it if you looked inside.
Wow.
It was really amazing. But what we do is we take this glass, little glass pin, and we'd stick it down in there, not with your hands. You'd stick it down in there and it would break it and then suck up just a little piece of it. And then we'd pour the rest of it into a little mold, and we would test the piece because we'd take it right from the middle in the liquid form. So when we would test that with the computer, no matter what was on the outside, you're going to know the exact purity of what it actually was. So people would come in and say, this is 14 karat gold because this is what I bought it as. And then we would test it and it'd actually be 10 karat gold, maybe with 14 karat plating on it. But you don't know the true nature of the gold, the true purity of it, until it goes through a fire.
Wow.
And you realize, you look at your life, we're so obedient on the outside, but it's not until you get into the middle of a fire that you know what's actually on the inside. So you don't know where your faith lies until you go into a fire. And I believe so many people miss the storm and they don't go through the fire because they choose something else instead. And there's always going to be something else.
But you can be in the middle of the fire and think, if I just wasn't in this fire, mm-hmm, I could act as pure gold.
That's right. Because you look like one thing, but you're really something else.
Wow.
And I believe, I just felt this morning. Me and Elijah read this twice, and he was trying to go back to sleep, but you're right. We read it together. I think we need to take a look at what we actually are on the inside. Like, how pure are we? We're really good at convincing ourselves. I know that. We lie to ourselves all the time. But what are we really on the inside?
Amen.
And I believe, and this morning it was amazing because I realized that some of the things that I've gotten free of over the last couple of years are things that I've never told anybody in all my life. And they're not like really shameful things, but they're things that I wasn't real with myself about. You know? And as soon as I let those things get mixed up, and all of a sudden the fire was hot enough to where those things were right in the middle, I had to make a choice. Because when we pour the gold in, and there's impurities a little bit around the outside, you can still test a piece, a bar of gold, and if you're not testing the core of it, you don't know what it's really made of. And so I think a lot of us, we partly go through fires, but we don't like what it's exposing, so we shut down and we move on. And those things never come all the way up to the surface, and so we stay 14 karat. Because the refining process is not just melting it down. The refining process is this incredibly intense, long, slow process of actually making it 24 karat gold, because you've got to get everything else out. Everything out. It's incredible.
So it's not 24 karat until it's pure?
It's not 24 karat until all the way.
Okay, so that makes me think of what I learned yesterday. Well, I was listening to T. Joshua, who's my favorite teacher, and he started teaching on something that the Lord had taught me about 3.5 years ago. I've been wondering if I should teach more from those encounters. And this is the third confirmation that I should. I remember one day, and some of you have heard me talk about this, but I don't know that I brought you in so you can learn how to do it. And so that's what's shifting now. I kind of thought some of these things were for me. And I knew the Lord said back then, release it, but he's straightening me out. How many of us need straightening out? He said, lay down. I'm just walking through my house, and the Lord said, lay down. So I laid down, and he said, surrender to me. And I said, there's more? Because I had just spent probably 3 to 4 month process of repentance every day, all day, deliverance, purifying, and I was a little surprised, because I'll be honest, I thought that we got everything out. And I said, there's more? And he said, there's always more. And he said, remember, every time you release something of yourself to me, I release something of myself to you. This is what it looks like. You give me your trash, I give you my treasure.
Amen.
You give me your garbage, I give you my gold. I said, Lord, here's more garbage. He said, your garbage in your heart piles up more quickly than your kitchen. Take it out. Don't ask me to pour in treasure when you not remove the trash. Okay? And how many of you have heard me talk about that? Okay. Well, I just thought that those encounters are beautiful, and I'll share them with people, but I haven't really taught you how to do that. And I was shocked yesterday. T.B. Joshua was teaching, and if you don't know who this is, he's a man that I, in my opinion, probably, that I know personally, walks in the greatest power and humility and wisdom. And anyway, so he's teaching thousands of people in his church, and then who knows how many online. No, he has this faith bracelet made up. He had these faith bracelets made. And he said, don't put your faith in the bracelets. They're just to help you learn a habit. And this is what he's wanting to learn. To meditate on what it said. And the one prayer that he put on there was, Lord, take more of me and give you more of you. And he's teaching his people to meditate on this all day. In your office, while you're talking to your employer, while you're with your children. He said, even while I'm ministering to you, your heart can be praying. Pray without ceasing. He's teaching them how to pray without ceasing. How many of you think that pray without ceasing is just kind of a nice idea, but you could never do it? Why would we think that this part of the Bible is for us and this part isn't?
Amen.
Why do we think? We think because we couldn't do it. That's why we think. But can he?
Yes.
Can he do it? So then you ask him to do it. So then you ask him how. Places in our lives that don't become transformed are usually because we think we don't deserve it because we can't do it. Once we can give all those places to him and go, we're not worthy. We can't do it. But the blood has made us worthy. And he will do it. I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. But he has these people, his people, meditating on, Lord, take more of me and give me more of you. He said, what are you saying when you say that prayer? You're saying, take more of my nature, which is disobedience, impurity, whatever it is, rebellion. Mm-hmm. Give me more of your nature, which are the fruits of the Spirit. Kindness, gentleness, long-suffering. And I was like, oh my word. We want to bear fruit. Mm-hmm. And we've seen fruit as souls saved. Fruit is the character of God.
Wow.
Fruit in your life is when you begin displaying the nature of God.
Yeah.
Wow.
It's not how many people you can have at your gathering or you can bring to church. That is necessary. Did Jesus say go and make disciples of all men? Yes, he did. Yes, he did. The first way and be filled with power.
Yeah.
See, the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit and the Word. The Word without the Holy Spirit is dry and hard. The Holy Spirit without the grounding of the Word can be very flaky. You cannot separate God, His Word, from His Spirit. You cannot separate them.
Yeah.
So His Word, as you're learning His Word, His Word in your life with the Holy Spirit will begin to produce the nature of God. And it's going to be much easier to make disciples if you are a true disciple.
Uh-huh.
If you're not a disciple of Christ, how can you make disciples of Christ? You might make disciples of you.
Woo!
Right?
You might make disciples of a culture of some church. You might make disciples of, culture. Culture of a church, a culture of a movement. But if you are not a true disciple of Christ, what are you making them disciples of?
Right.
You're making employees.
Yeah, you can bring many employees.
Wow.
But we are to make disciples. Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ. If you're not even following Christ, why would you want anyone following you? Please don't want followers.
Amen.
If you're not following Christ, if you're truly following Christ, people will naturally follow you.
Amen.
Don't seek to lead.
Wow.
Seek to follow.
Amen.
That's right.
Seek to follow.
You're talking about that fruit. It's love the Lord your God with all. And just add everything else. That is fruit. Because then when you love Him, you take Him.
Amen.
It's so simple. Can I tell a TB Joshua story?
Please.
So TB came on my phone this morning, live.
It's on TB.
TB? And, he's hard to buy him, but, huh?
I didn't get his vibe.
He's trying to show me. I don't know much about
it. You get, like, notifications just like, press on.
Oh, YouTube. It came up. So he's walking down the aisle, and he's slapping people on the head, and he's prophesying over people, and he gets to this one guy, and he slaps him on the head, and this guy was a big guy, and he was not happy about it. So he says, stand up. So this guy stands up and he pops him on the head again. And this guy like bowed up on him. And this guy said, I am a big man. So I was like, some lies. So TB Joshua said, okay, big man, come here. And he brought him out and he's laughing at him. And so he said, you're a big man? He said, I'm a big man. He said, get on your knees. And this, all of a sudden this dude collapses to his knees. And TB Joshua was laughing, but he's teaching the whole time.
Yeah.
And then he says, roll over. And this dude like flips over on his back. And he says, see, now you are free. And he slaps him and rolls on. Well, they come back to this guy who's laid out for like 10 or 15 minutes.
Wow.
And when he stood up, he said, are you still a big man? And he said, what? He said, are you still a big man? He said, I never said that. I realized it was so amazing to me because he didn't know how influenced he was by the demon. And yet he showed up to church. And so what, just along the lines of what you're saying, we don't want to make people that follow you. When you walk in the full authority and power of Jesus, that stuff can't stay around. And I love what Sean is saying because he'll walk up to people and just intimidates the devil just by looking at him. And he gets closer to him and they just start to, you know, start to leave. It's just amazing to me that is available. And that's how you make disciples. Like, you can't disciple a demon.
Yeah.
So when you get somebody to follow a thing or follow you, that demon stays.
Yeah. Yes.
And it's going to wreak havoc in your life instead of wreaking havoc in their life.
Amen.
So it's you've got to go through the fire. You've got to be purified so that it's him and not you.
That's right.
Yeah, don't give you away. I mean, you're amazing. No offense, but don't give you away.
Wow.
Yes.
Wow.
Second Timothy. So much. Thank you, Lord. I was talking last night about many copy people. Paul says the imitators of God. But many times we are imitators of people. And when he was preaching this morning, he was talking about the only place you can find your true worth is in the Word of God by the Holy Spirit. And he said, if you do not know your true value, you will become a copy of someone. How many of you have ever felt yourself being influenced by the culture of the world? We don't want to be. We do not want to conform to this world. We transform by renewing our mind. Okay, I know what it was. How many of you have ever felt in a moment, listen to me carefully. Elijah, you can listen too, honey. How many of you have ever felt in a moment completely and utterly free? Raise your hand. I want to say to you, that is who you really are. And I want to ask you to never accept anything less. In that moment when you have felt fully alive, fully free, that is who you are. And sometimes we can think, oh, that's who we were in that moment, but see, I'm still not. No. That I'm still not is the lie. That I am because he is the truth. Mm-hmm. What is bringing me back to that is the Lord said, do not accept phases in your children's lives to allow them to act like the devil.
Come on.
He said, I will show you the real Elijah. Now, from now on, you know who the real Elijah is. If you see anything but that, the devil is involved. Mm-hmm. Get him out.
Wow.
Not through whipping. I'm not preaching against any form of whatever. I'm talking about getting it out through love, through patience, through deliverance,
yes.
Through the Word of God.
Yes.
So, it started this week, Elijah was being influenced. Lord, where is it coming from? He showed me the source. The source was a person who's very disrespectful against authority. Mm-hmm. So guess what? Elijah is becoming very disrespectful against authority. So I started praying about that, removed him from that situation. I began praying and fasting. I began going to his bed at night and speaking in tongues and declaring freedom over him. So this past Wednesday night, we get in the car, and the Holy Spirit, you cannot do this without connection with the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
You cannot read enough articles. Amen. You cannot have good enough intentions. The Bible says, I will teach your children, and great will be their peace. He will not teach them if you continue teaching them according to your head, mm-hmm. and your flesh, and your past, and what your parents did, and what they didn't do. Do you understand what I'm saying? Yeah. Now, I'm speaking not only to parents of children, but spiritual children. As people come into your life and you become mentoring, we're going to have soon, I pray, your house will be open to deliverance. And we'll have programs you can go through and teach you how to take people through deliverance. It won't always be our living room. Amen?
Amen.
Who in here, you don't have to raise your hand, but think about it. Who has a desire you wish your house could just be open every day for the Lord? I'm praying a financial blessing on you. I thought that this morning. Very strong. But when you get the resources that the Lord sends, make sure your heart is in sync.
Amen.
We're going to start teaching. The Bible sends very specific instructions for wealthy people.
Yes.
And he asked me why I haven't been teaching on it. So I'm going to teach. But when you become wealthy, remember, write it down. Realize you need God. Okay, right there. Set an alarm for 5 years from now when you have a significant increase in your finances and you remember you wanted to open your house every day.
Yeah.
5 years from now? You 5 years you can do that?
Do it? I don't know. Write it down. I don't know.
I'm sure
you can. You could do, like, a planned email to yourself.
Set an alarm that on this day, in 1 year, ask the Lord to lead you. Who are you following?
Come on.
Your reasoning? Your mother? Your culture? Or the Holy Spirit? Let me tell you, if you are not connected to the Holy Spirit, I don't know what to tell you. Who in this room is learning to connect to the Holy Spirit?
Yes.
Yeah.
Otherwise, we are not doing our job. Our job is to not get you to follow us, but to follow Him. Follow us as we follow Christ.
Yep.
But if your life is not producing the character of God, you know, not that that's all our fault, but this is what the church is for. The church is for the building up and the equipping of the saints.
Yes.
It is a house of prayer. Amen?
Amen.
So, you see your true nature when you're free. So the Lord was telling me, about Elijah, so we're praying, fasting, speaking in tongues, doing deliverance. One thing that he told me, every time your children present an issue, listen to them. So one time, Elijah was, in the car, and he was fussing about being late, and fussing about people who were late. And he has a sermon for everybody. We need to be on time and dress well. So I told him, find the scripture to back that up, I'll let him preach. So anyway, so he's fussing about people who are late. Blah, 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 blah. And I was like, Elijah, when was the first time that you felt like you were frustrated about being late? And he told me that time. We went back to that because that time he was being influenced by a situation that was not proper. It was not from the heart of God. So there was literally an opening in his heart where he received this. You see what I'm saying? We went in, repented of the issue that caused it, and declared healing over him. That night, we leave church, and I hear the Lord say, don't go into your own heart or your mind. Don't even come and bond with me right now. Reach out to Elijah, who's on the passenger side. I instantly reached my hand out. He grabs under my hand. Some of y'all heard this story. He begins talking about his fear of eternity. But Mom, eternity, I don't understand it. I can't comprehend that. Forever? That's scary. Mom, I know what to do on earth. If I'm bored here, I know what to do. What if I'm bored there? It lasts forever? I don't know about forever. And we're talking about different things. Then he says, wait a minute. I forgot about the beginning. Now I remember the beginning. I'm like, what do you mean? He said, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And he said, so God was just chilling. He decided to make the universe, make the earth, make me. What am I worried about? Mm-hmm. And I understood what he was saying. If you live like this, earth is your home, and that you're going to have to leave your home to go somewhere unknown, you might be in trouble. But if you live like God is your home, the God who was outside of time, who was before earth, is with earth, and will be after earth. What have you got to worry about? But that's only through making yourself at home in Him here.
Amen.
So then he goes, well, I better get serious about this. Because I certainly don't want to think about hell for eternity. And he said, so I need to start paying my tithes. This was his words. Pay my tithes, read my word, and really start worshiping. Okay, well, what I saw this week from his life is a text message from my mother saying, a day after he'd spent the day with her, tell Elijah that my leg has no pain. And I said, what do you mean, Mom? She said, I had a terrible pain, the kind that I used to have to be on a walker for a long time. And Elijah asked me, could he pray for me? And I am healed. I am not hurting since. Okay. Yesterday, I'm not joking, we're with his cousin, His cousin falls off a moving trailer, lands on his elbow. Then
gets, just on the trailer.
Okay. Oh. Then gets tackled by Elijah into a pile of logs that are waiting to form the trampoline, so metal on that elbow. So he comes, and I gently pray for him, but I thought it was fine. Then he comes out, his elbow's like this. Okay, so this is my elbow. It'd be like if there was this now. I'm not joking. All of a sudden, I see Elijah pray. Mm-hmm. I asked Shiloh if he's praying. He said, I prayed in my spirit. And I said, Father, for you. I said, pray so the devil can hear you. He said, oh, he can hear me in my spirit. I just let that go. At least he's praying.
Oh, he can hear me.
Yeah, we can hear you. I would pray for him. Let me tell you, within 30, 40 minutes, that was this.
Come on.
I asked him a few hours later, are you in pain? He said, no, it's
no pain.
From that?
Yeah.
He put ice on it. Is ice going to cure that? That fast? You would know more than I would know. Would ice cure that fast? So, but see, before Elijah got his heart right with God again last Wednesday night, he wasn't praying for people. In fact, asking is very approaching. So, what I'm saying is, remember who you really are. Remember that moment where you felt fully alive. Don't be tricked by hopelessness, by despair, by anxiety, by fear. That is not who you are. Don't believe it for a second. And I challenge you, every time you feel less than who you really are, which means who God really is in you, get back. Don't work on yourself. Don't work on yourself. Don't work on yourself. Get back to Him. Connect with His Spirit. His Spirit will bring His nature. Before long, you'll be better than you ever dreamed you could be. I could hear myself this morning saying, I need you, God. And I could hear that some people hate that prayer. They don't want to say, I need you, God. Because that seems too desperate, too hopeless, too maybe, maybe not. No, that is only if you do not believe that He will answer that prayer.
Good.
Those people, the reason they don't want to say, I need you, God, those are the ones that are going, ah, you're amazing. You're enough. You're amazing, you're enough. You know why? Because they are more tangible to them than Jesus is. They are lovers of themselves.
Jesus.
And I said that this morning, and Lisa was like reading it. She went to bed reading that last night, that they will be lovers of themselves. In the last days, there will be difficult times where people will love only themselves and their money. They will be boastful and proud, scoffing at God, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful. They will consider nothing sacred. They will be unloving and unforgiving. They will slander others and have no self-control. They will be cruel and hate what is good. They will betray their friends, be reckless, be puffed up with pride, and love pleasure rather than God. They will act religious, but they will reject the power that can make them godly. Stay away from people like that.
Where is that?
2 Timothy 2. Read all of it.
Yeah.
You need to know what to look out for in the last days. But I'm telling you, someone who loves themselves more than God will need you to tell them they're enough. And they will tell you they're enough. There are leaders of churches telling you you're enough because they desperately need you to make them feel like they're enough. If you can let go of your enough, if you can understand you never have been, you never will be enough.
Yes.
But God is. And because He is in you, you are. If your life is in Him and His life is in you, does this make sense?
Yes.
If you keep trying to be enough, you're going to keep failing. You're going to keep slammed with depression. Stay slammed with guilt. You might rise up every once in a while, but it will be in pride, not in power. But if we can be nothing, so He can be everything, amen, then you can rise up in His power. Who wants to be their real self in Christ?
Yes.
Amen. Who will listen to me and say, the next time you feel that less than, I'm a worm, I never make it, a la 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 la, you will at that point rebuke the devil. And take the word of God and say, Lord, make me, Lord, make me like you.
Yes.
Go here, go here. Oh, yes. But in awe and reverence and holiness, yes, make me like you. Make me like you, Lord. Instead of closing off to the feelings, or denying it, or acting like everything's fine, or rising up in pride. No, go, 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 go low in humility.
Amen.
I need you, God, make me like you.
Yeah.
With confidence that he will.
Yes.
If you ask without faith, you'll have nothing.
Wow.
Ask in faith, believing. Then we'll do it.
Yes.
Me too.
Oh,
you to call it out in your spirit and tell it to leave you now. I want you to breathe it out. If it's pride, if it's lust, if it's the spirit of loneliness, if it's the spirit of despair, if it's the spirit of unbelief, tell it to leave you now. Every spirit of rebellion, every spirit of outcast, that you are outcast, you always have been, you always will be, I break that label off you right now in the name of Jesus. You're going to be delivered right now. You're going to be delivered right now. Oh, every unclean spirit, go now. As you're being delivered, breathe it out, breathe it out, breathe it out. Be delivered now in the name of Jesus. Be delivered of loneliness and despair right now. Every suicidal thought, go now in the name of Jesus. Be delivered now in the name of Jesus. Be delivered now in the name of Jesus. See it going. That dark.
yesterday talking to our pastors, worship pastor. I'm telling you, we're coming now to the outpouring. By the way, if anybody wants to go, June 7th to 9th in Louisiana, the outpouring conference. And they might need our help with singing and playing. And so I was talking to his worship pastor about that, and I said, these people are worshipers. And he said, oh, I told Dr. Nikos that I have no problem with anyone because they sit under y'all. Because of your fire for God, y'all's passion for Jesus. This is what he said. He said, I know I won't have to worry about if there's hidden sin in their lives. He didn't ask me if y'all can sing well. His only concern was with every hidden sin.
God.
No, if you sit up in this ministry, God's going to show it. Amen. And then he says, y'all are getting an Airbnb? That might be what we do. He said, well, I've heard about y'all. And he said, I'm coming to the Airbnb after service.
Yeah!
Make it, make it. Not for us, for him.